Now, before buying a MacBook, you need to answer these three questions. First of all, do you need a MacBook Air or a MacBook Pro? Then which size do you need? And then finally, which configuration would work best for you? So let's talk about the important differences between the five M3 MacBooks, and this way you could have all the information that you need to choose the right MacBook for you. We're going to start out with the least expensive model, the 13-inch MacBook Air, and then work our way up. And this was a relatively incremental update from the M2 model. It starts out at $1,100, which is actually $100 less than the M2 model was when it was released. And this makes sense because there's a lot of similarities, starting with the identical design, shape, and weight, all of which were major upgrades with the previous model. What's great is that, again, we're getting an extremely capable MacBook that's also super portable. If you're upgrading from any MacBook Air prior to the M1 models, you're in for a huge jump in performance. And in fact, the MacBook Air has the same M3 chip that you get on the 14-inch M3 MacBook Pro. The only difference is that we're starting out with an 8-core CPU and an 8-core GPU, and it can be upgraded to a 10-core GPU for an additional $100. And the M3 MacBook Pro only comes with a 10-core GPU. Now, typically, this GPU upgrade is not something that I recommend for most users because the target audience for the MacBook Air isn't super likely to benefit from additional GPU performance. And I would rather that you upgrade other components first. And we're gonna go ahead and talk about those later on. Now, looking at the display, it's the same 13.6-inch liquid retina display that we had on the M2 model. It's bright, it has small bezels, it's a P3 display, which is a wider color gamut, and it supports 1 billion colors. So whether you're just using this MacBook for school, for work, to surf the web, or to watch content, this display is very good. It's not at the same level as the 14 or 16 inch displays, but we'll get to those in just a moment. Now, the 4-speaker system is practically invisible in the hinge, and considering the design, they get plenty loud, they offer spatial audio, and they work well for watching movies, for playing games, or for video calls. Just like with the display, these aren't as good as the ones that we're getting on the higher end MacBooks, but they're very good laptop speakers. Now, the camera is the same 1080p camera that we have on the rest of the lineup. It's noticeably better than the 720p one that we had on the M1 model. And again, we're combining this hardware with the new ISP, or image signal processor, on the M3 chip. So we're getting a better overall image with improved low light performance. The keyboard is excellent. It's the same in every model in this entire lineup, and it might be the best keyboard on any laptop that I've tested. It's a great size, it's solid, there is no give when you press on the board, and the keys themselves are responsive and have a good amount of feedback. Now, looking at the trackpad, Apple probably makes my favorite trackpad. They're extremely responsive and accurate. You can press anywhere, and the only difference between the various models is the size. As far as ports, we're getting 2 Thunderbolt 3 / USB 4 ports and a MagSafe port on the left side, and then a 3.5mm headphone jack on the right. Now, it's important to mention that because all three ports are on the left side, you can only attach accessories or charge the MacBook Air from one side. As far as configuration options, we start out with 8GB of unified memory, which can be upgraded to 16 or 24. And for internal storage, we start out with 256GB and go all the way up to 2TB. Now, keep in mind that none of these MacBooks can be upgraded. So make sure that you get a configuration that will serve your needs for the life of the device. For example, I would upgrade to 16GB of unified memory instead of adding GPU cores. And as far as internal storage, get as much as you need for apps and local files, and then supplement with much less expensive external SSDs. You can easily get a fast 2TB external SSD for under $150. Now, when it comes to external display support, there's been some confusion. So the M3 MacBook Air supports a single external 6K 60Hz display if you still want to use the display on the laptop itself. If you close the MacBook Air, then it will support another 5K 60Hz display. So the maximum number of displays you're getting is 2. Now, battery size and rating remain excellent. We're getting an upgraded chip, dual external display support, and an upgrade to Wi-Fi 6E. So just like the previous model, this is an outstanding option for the overwhelming majority of users who need a powerful, light, and portable MacBook for everyday use, for school, or general business needs. Now, say that you love the thin and sleek design, but you want a larger display. That's when you step up to the 15-inch M3 MacBook Air. It starts out at $1,300, so technically $200 more than the 13-inch model, but it already includes the $100 upgrade to the 10-core GPU. Again, we're getting an 8-core CPU. It starts out with 8 gigabytes of unified memory and can be upgraded to 16 or 24. And the internal storage again starts out at 256 gigs and can go all the way up to 2 terabytes. Now, as far as SSD speeds, if you're familiar with any of the M1 or M2 MacBooks, you already know that the 256 gigabyte versions of the MacBook Airs, both the 13 and the 15, come with significantly slower SSD speeds than the larger sizes. We also found some super interesting differences when it came to large file transfer speeds, which I show in this comparison with the 16-inch MacBook Pro, so check it out if you're interested. We're essentially getting the same features and functions as the 13-inch model, but with a noticeably larger 15.3-inch display, which also has a higher resolution. Another upgrade is going from 4 speakers to a 6-speaker sound system with force-canceling woofers. So on the 15-inch MacBook Air, we're getting a fuller sound and better overall audio quality. We're getting a larger trackpad and a larger palm rest assembly, so it's a bit more comfortable to type on. And while we have a larger battery at 16.5 watt hours versus 52.6 on the 13-inch model, we're getting the same rating for 15 hours of wireless web and 18 hours of Apple TV movie playback. Now, as far as power adapter, the 13-inch model comes with a 30-watt single port adapter and then an optional $20 upgrade to a 35-watt dual USB-C power adapter. The 15-inch MacBook Air already comes with the dual port adapter. And both laptops can accept up to 70 watts for fast charging. As far as colors, both MacBook Air models are available in space gray, silver, starlight, and then midnight, which is supposed to be more fingerprint resistant than the previous midnight finish. But I have both and I haven't really noticed a major difference. Now, neither of the MacBook Airs has a fan, so they're absolutely silent. For external display support, again, we're looking at a single external display if you're using the MacBook display, and then 2 displays if you close the 15-inch MacBook Air. But if you've seen my MacBook accessories video, I showed you how to connect 3 external 4K displays to any Mac or MacBook that has at least an M1 chip in it. And that's in addition to the MacBook display itself. In that video, I was using the PD2725U, but BenQ actually makes 3 different models specifically designed for Mac users. These monitors don't just look great, but they're shipped with default color settings that perfectly match MacBook colors. They also have something called MBook mode, which provides active color syncing, so the colors on the MacBook display and the color on the BenQ displays look the same. And this way, if I'm editing videos or photos, I know that I can trust the colors that I see. They have plenty of ports, and the stand is super versatile, so you can tilt your display, lower or raise it, and easily switch between landscape and portrait mode. They have a built-in KVM switch, so you can use the same display, keyboard, and mouse with 2 different devices. And I love the Hotkey Puck G2 because it gives me easy access to all of the monitor's features without having to mess around with tiny buttons on the back of the monitor. So click the link in the description to learn more about BenQ's 3 displays designed specifically for Macs, and thank you to BenQ for sponsoring this portion of the video. All right, so now we're getting to the biggest update of this year's lineup, and that's the new 14-inch M3 MacBook Pro, which replaces the 13-inch M2 MacBook Pro. And here, things get a little confusing because of how Apple named their MacBooks and their chips. So this is the 14-inch M3 MacBook Pro, and we also have a 14-inch M3 Pro MacBook Pro, and you'll see in a minute that while they look very similar, they don't have the same features. So starting out, we have a much thicker body than even the 15-inch MacBook Air, but we have the same overall shape. The MacBook Pro has 2 Thunderbolt 3 ports, a MagSafe port, and a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack on the left, then an SDXC card reader and an HDMI port on the right. Now, I love the SDXC card reader on the MacBook Pro. This way I don't have to bring a dedicated card reader or an adapter with me whenever I travel, but I know that that's not meaningful for everyone. Also, the HDMI port gives you compatibility with more monitors without needing an adapter. But we're actually taking a step back with external display support because the M3 MacBook Pro only supports a single display with up to 6K 60 Hertz over Thunderbolt, or a single display with up to 4K 144 Hertz over HDMI. So regardless of whether the MacBook is open or closed, you can't use 2 external display, which is strange for a Pro device considering that it's a feature that's available on the Air. Now, looking at the built-in display, we're getting a nice upgrade with a 14.2-inch Liquid Retina XDR display. And this is the same display that we're getting on the higher-end M3 Pro MacBook Pro. It's an absolutely incredible incredible display. It's super sharp. The colors look amazingly crisp. And because it's a mini LED display versus LCD on the MacBook Air, we're getting more dimming zones with darker blacks. Now, the MacBook Pro is 100 nits brighter for SDR content and goes up to 1,000 nits of sustained full screen brightness and 1,600 nits peak brightness for HDR content. Now, if all you watch is SDR content, then it's not a major difference, but more and more content is being created in HDR, and then the difference is definitely noticeable. It also has ProMotion, which is Apple's adaptive refresh rate of up to 120 hertz. And essentially, depending on what you're doing, the display can go from 24 hertz all the way up to 120 hertz in order to optimize the user experience and maximize battery life. We're getting a slightly smaller trackpad than the 15-inch MacBook Air and the black keyboard well, which I love. All of the MacBooks now have a full height row of function keys and a large Touch ID button, so no more touch bar, which I actually like, but some of you are gonna miss and some of you are not. We're getting the same 1080p camera, but the speakers are upgraded to a high fidelity 6-speaker system. And I know this sounds similar to what we're getting with the 15-inch MacBook Air, but these speakers are now positioned on the side of the keyboard and the sound quality is noticeably better. Now, all three Pro models come with an active cooling system or fans, which means that there's no drop in performance as the CPU is being pushed to 100% for a long period of time versus the MacBook Air models that show about a 7.5% drop. And this is because the CPU on the MacBook Air has to throttle back performance in order to keep the temperature down. The M3 MacBook Pro starts out at $1,600, and that's with an 8-core CPU, a 10-core GPU, 8 gigabytes of unified memory, and 512 gigabytes of internal storage. So we are getting the faster SSD, but we're still looking at 100 gigabytes per second of memory bandwidth. That's the same as the MacBook Air. The unified memory can be upgraded to 16 or 24, and the internal storage can go up to 2 terabytes, again, just like the MacBook Air. We're getting a 70 watt hour battery with the same rating for wireless web as the MacBook Air, but 4 hours longer for Apple TV app movie playback. We're also getting a 70 watt USB-C power adapter and an optional $20 upgrade to a 96 watt adapter, which is the maximum this MacBook will accept for fast charging. So now we're getting to the higher end MacBooks that come with the M3 Pro and M3 Max chips. And again, this year, Apple didn't change anything about the design and focused on performance. We're getting the same incredible display as the M3 MacBook Pro, the same keyboard, trackpad, and the exact same design, except that it comes in this super cool space black instead of space gray. Now, as far as ports, we see some meaningful upgrades that actually make this more of a pro device. We're getting 3 Thunderbolt 4 ports, one on the right and 2 on the left, so you can connect accessories and charge this MacBook from both sides. We're also getting an HDMI port and SDXC card reader on the right and a MagSafe 3 port on the left. If you get the 14-inch model with an M3 Pro chip, you can connect up to 2 6K 60 hertz display. If you get it with an M3 Max chip, you can connect up to 3 6K 60 hertz display and a fourth 4K 144 hertz display over HDMI. So if you wanted to, you could set up a very powerful and versatile workstation and essentially use this MacBook as a desktop. Now, speaking of the two variations of the chip, the M3 Pro comes with either an 11 or 12 core CPU, a 14 or 18 core GPU. It starts out with 18 gigabytes of unified memory and goes up to 36 gigs, and starts out with 512 gigabytes of internal storage and goes as high as 8 terabytes. When compared with the M3 chip, the M3 Pro gives us 2 or 3 additional performance cores and 2 additional efficiency cores, and we can see the difference in multi-core performance. We're also getting better GPU performance and faster memory bandwidth. If you need even better performance, then you can go with the M3 Max chip, which goes all the way up to a 16-core CPU, a 14-core GPU, 120 gigabytes of unified memory, and the fastest memory bandwidth. Now, keep in mind that that setup would be complete overkill for the overwhelming majority of users, and at the same time, it would absolutely crush what super demanding users need. Simply put, if you don't know that you need an M3 Max, you don't need an M3 Max. Now, these powerful chips do take a toll on the battery. So even with a slightly larger battery, we're looking at 12 hours of wireless web and 18 hours of Apple TV. Which brings us to the biggest and baddest MacBook. It's definitely bigger and heavier, but the 16.2-inch display is absolutely gorgeous. It's a larger version of the Liquid Retina XDR XDR display that we saw on the 14-inch model, and this might be the nicest display on any laptop that I've used. So this happens to be the MacBook that I take with me when I travel. We're essentially getting the same features and functions as a 14-inch, but the speakers are even better. These actually might be the best speakers on any laptop that I've ever tested, other than the previous models of this exact MacBook. We're getting the biggest trackpad, and while the keyboard is the same size, the larger palm assembly again makes typing more comfortable for me. When comparing prices, keep in mind that there is no M3 version of this Max, just M3 Pro and M3 Max, and while it has the same Max configurations as the 14-inch model, it starts out with a 12-core CPU and an 18-core GPU, which are a $200 upgrade on the 14-inch. We're also getting a more powerful 140-watt power adapter for fast charging, which brings me to battery life. So the 16-inch MacBook Pro has a higher rating than the 14-inch M3 Pro MacBook Pro, but the same rating as the M3 MacBook Pro, which puts it at a tie for the lead. I've been using all five of these since they were released, and the battery life is absolutely outstanding on all of them. With a typical workload, I have plenty of battery life at the end of the day, and I only charge them every 2 to 3 days. And it's mostly during days where I'm editing video or batch processing hundreds of images that I notice the additional capacity. If you don't absolutely need the latest and greatest MacBooks, I would also consider looking at the M2 or even the M1 models. I've made plenty of videos about those as well. You know what I always say? Buy it nice or buy it twice. Good luck and see you soon.